my specialty is in the history of Germany. Actually, my real specialty is on East Germany. But if you're going to get a PhD in German history, like, part of the deal is you get to learn the history of National Socialism, because it's important. I mean, you just fundamentally can't understand German history without it. I came up a few years ago with the idea of doing lectures on Holocaust Remembrance Day. The Holocaust Remembrance Day is the 27th, which was the date that the Red Army liberated Auschwitz. I'm just going to say this before we get going any further. I really, really try to follow Max Weber's, the German sociologist Max Weber's, sort of dictum that you ought not to preach politics from the lectern. But I will say this, and I apologize if this impinges on anyone's views. The statement the other day about the Holocaust remembrance, which did not mention the Jews, I thought was very dangerous. The Nazi genocide and the Holocaust is part of Nazi genocide, but it's not the same thing as Nazi genocide. The Jews had a very singular place in Nazi ideology that was different from everybody else. The Nazis murdered a lot of other people, and I don't say this to minimize their suffering, but you can't talk about the Holocaust without talking about the Jews. The Jews were absolutely central to what National Socialism was about, and if you don't do that, it was just very creepy to read that. So I think that we should, with respect to the victims, and really the reason, one big reason for doing this is to sort of remember the people who were murdered, the people who were victimized by National Socialism. We can't do that effectively if we're going to engage in this sort of slippage about the Holocaust was just a bunch of people who got killed. I want to do these lectures sort of to talk about sort of why it happened. I did sort of survival in Auschwitz last year, which was interesting. I want to not sort of do a lot of lectures in which I get into the minutia of the Holocaust. It's a grim subject. I have some suggestions for reading in there. I know an awful lot about it. I'm sure plenty of you do too. I know things that I would very much prefer to forget about it if I could, but I think that sort of one service that we can do, or one homage that we can do to the victims, is by just talking about what were the precursors of it happening. And so just to sort of frame this discussion, the way there's sort of relatively few really good general treatments of the history of National Socialism. In the immediate wake of the war, there was a lot of history, and it was very centered on, it was kind of narrative like Scheurer. It was focused on people. It was focused on Hitler did this, Himmler did this, Goering did this, which is not wrong. But it sort of creates the view that that the Holocaust, you can sort of understand it through its major figures. And I think that that's, historians sort of came around to the idea that that's a kind of wrong way to look at it, or an overly narrow way to look at it. So starting in the 1970s, late 1970s, and really coming to a head in 1981, there was another movement of whom Martine Brojat was one of the major figures, that tried to look at what were the sort of institutional processes that allowed it to happen. So there's two big ways of thinking. I'll just sort of let you into the kind of academic look at it. There's what's called intentionalism and functionalism, or sometimes structuralism. People use the terms differently. But intentionalism basically focuses on what looks at the Holocaust particularly, but what happened in National Socialism generally, as the result of intentions that were in Hitler's head, and intentions that were in the heads of the major Nazi leadership. And that's not wrong. Hitler had a lot of nasty views about the Jews, which he expressed to anybody who would listen, starting, before the war, before the First World War. I say the war, where there's two world wars in play here, but And which in Mein Kampf, which we'll talk a little bit about later, he said some very grim things. Now, we want to be careful about drawing a straight line from that to the Holocaust. Lots of people said very grim things about Jews. I mean, anti-Semitism was a major problem in Europe. But let's just say, too, if you would have asked an educated European in 1900 where they thought mass violence against the Jews was going to break out, Germany would not have been probably in their top five picks. They would have more likely said maybe Russia, where bands called the Black Hundreds were undertaking pogroms and murdering hundreds, sometimes thousands of Jews. Or in France, where the Dreyfus Affair rumbled on for the best part of a decade and a half, in which a Jewish army officer was falsely accused of treason, was sent off to Devil's Island, basically, and then it sort of the struggles over that roiled French society for a long time. Germany was a place where the Jewish population was less than right around 0.5% of the population, and was very well integrated into the population, such that the Jewish Gemeinde in Berlin, the Jewish community organization, was a little worried that intermarriage between Jews and non-Jews was so prevalent that the Jewish community was being diluted. So the idea that that there's some sort of specifically German predisposition, this is an idea that a fellow named Daniel Jonah Goldhagen, who's a political scientist at Harvard at the time, made a lot of hay out of, that Germans had this sort of predisposition to want to kill Jews. He called it eliminationist anti-Semitism. And I just think that I said this maybe in one of the other lectures, that Eberhard Jaeckel, the German historian, reviewed Hitler's Willing Executioners, Goldhagen's book, and the title of the review was Einfach ein schlechtes Buch, simply a bad book. And I think that's a pretty fair judgment. I will say, too, as a sort of caveat emptor sort of thing, Goldhagen is a political scientist. Political scientists and historians are very different in the way they approach things. Political scientists are sort of looking for regularities that can be sort of theoretically expressed. Historians are looking for kind of particularities. So we always think that the social scientists are kind of cherry picking, things. Whereas we're, so if you heard a social scientist or a political scientist talk about it, they might have a different view. But so anyway, there was this intentionalist view, and then these people like Brojot came along and said, look, Hitler didn't really, if you look at Hitler's management style, Hitler wasn't the kind of guy, in most cases, who was going to come along and say, do this, do that, I want this done this way. What he would do is sort of issue kind of general things that he wanted done, and then he would allow his subordinates to compete to see who could get it done and with what means. And it resulted in a kind of intensification of the process. And I'll just give you an example here. The people who were responsible for transporting the victims to the death camps were not in the first instance Deutsche Bahn, the German railway system. It was an organization called Kraft durch Freude, which means strength through joy. And Kraft durch Freude had, in the sort of pre-war era, been their sort of main thing was organizing holiday junkets and hiking trips to get people out in nature. But they had all this sort of institutional knowledge about how to get large numbers of people from one place to the other. And the leadership of the organization, when this kind of became clear what was going to happen, thought to themselves, well, this is a way we can get some real institutional power in this government. So the people running it were just this group who sort of came up with the best way of doing it. What we have now is a kind of, there's a kind of sort of swing back and forth in kind of how we view it. And we have to sort of, under the way we tend to understand it now, is that there's intentionalist elements and functionalist elements functioning together in a context that was dramatically intensified by the war too. So I originally thought, well, I'm going to do the whole history of National Socialism, which turned out to be, I thought better of it later. So what I'm going to do is, later this year, sometime when I can work it in with the major leaders of the Second World War series that I'm doing, I'm going to do, so for this lecture is going to be sort of up to 1933, up to the what's called the Machtergreifung, or the seizure of power. And then I'm going to do sort of National Socialism in power later, because it's a topic that's worth talking about. But I figured it would be so compressed if I tried to do all of it that it would, you know, not be suitably useful to people. All right, Germany in 1871. A lot of treatments of National Socialism wanted to look for the sort of history of National Socialism in the deep past. You know, it was German Lutheranism. It was the failure of the Enlightenment to take root in Germany. It was, you know, this sort of authoritarian character in Germany. But I really think that the roots of it are to be found in the German Empire. Now, the German Empire didn't come together as a unified nation until 1871. You can see here the sort of bits that was made up of. The Kingdom of Prussia, which was basically two-thirds of the land area and about two-thirds of the population, plus smaller, the Kingdom of Bavaria, smaller countries, the Kingdom of Hanover, the Kingdom of Württemberg, the Grand Duchy of Baden, Oldenburg, and these tiny little states like Saxony-Anhalt, Hesse-Darmstadt, and then free cities like Danzig right there, also Hamburg and Bremen up in the northern part of the country, Lübeck. And so they were sort of unified under the auspices of the Prussian king, and particularly through the agency of Otto von Bismarck in Schönhausen. Otto von Bismarck was a member of one of the oldest Pomeranian noble families. This is Pomerania out here. Came to power essentially in the early 1860s. There was in the Kingdom of Prussia. He was a sort of representative in the Prussian sort of House of Representatives, so to speak. The Prussia, somebody once said, I forget who, was like a state in the possession of an army. Like the army was seen by the Hohenzollern kings of Prussia as the sort of central institution of the state. And it was such that even though after the revolution of 1848 they'd had a sort of constitution of sorts that limited the power of the king, part of the constitution was that the military budget only got reviewed every 7 years. And that'll tell you a little something about the priorities. So basically they got to say what it was and then nobody got to talk about it for another 7 years or so. They had a sort of constitutional crisis about this in the early 1860s. And Bismarck was brought in because he was kind of wild man of German conservatism. Bismarck, oh my God, American conservatism is funny to me because it's really a kind of liberalism, like in the sort of capital L sense. For me, really, unless you think there ought to be a king, I don't buy conservatism. But that's just my prejudice. Bismarck was so conservative that, for him, like George W. Bush would have seemed like a raving radical. And he managed to resolve it, the crisis, mostly by threatening Parliament that they were just going to like dissolve it entirely and rule militarily. He also, in 1864, he got the Austrians together to seize Schleswig-Holstein from Denmark. In 1866, the Austrians found out that they'd figured out that they'd been had and went to war and lost badly. And then in 1871, he managed to convince Napoleon III to go to war with him, Napoleon III being the ruler of France. And this was the sort of moment that he was able to get all the other sort of little bits of Germany to come together and become the German Empire, the German Reich. The peculiarity of Bismarck was he was one of the most brilliant politicians in the history of Europe. Everybody admitted this. But he was very single-minded, and he systematically went through the German Foreign Service and stripped out anybody who he thought had any independent ideas whatsoever. Really, what he wanted his foreign policy bureaucrats to do was to do what he said, and not to have any independent ideas ever. And this turned out to have some very unfortunate consequences when he worked well with Wilhelm I, the king of, and then emperor of Germany, king of Prussia and then emperor of Germany. Wilhelm II, his son, who was a bit of a kook, his older brother was supposed to be king, Frederick. But Frederick, immediately upon assuming the throne, it turned out that he had throat cancer and he died within a matter of weeks. And then they brought in Wilhelm, his younger brother, who had a withered arm and some very weird ideas. And had never been, nobody ever thought he was going to be king, so they hadn't really prepared him very well for doing it. And he was always, God, he had so many strange ideas. He would go on these boat trips with his sort of cronies out in the North Sea for months on end, and the Foreign Service, Foreign Office would have to send bureaucrats with him, because whatever he said was the law, and he had to be sort of convinced not to say all kinds of things that would change German policy. Bismarck, as he did with Wilhelm's father, would frequently threaten to resign and take to his bed. But then in 1890 he threatened to resign, and Wilhelm II said, yeah, sure, that'd be a great idea. I'm going to bring in someone else. And this is all part of the sort of prehistory of the First World War, because the people who followed after Bismarck, Caprivi and Theobald von Bett von Hollweg, were not anywhere near as good at it as he was. And also, by this time too, Wilhelm II was really taking an active hand in government, which you really don't want a dilettante running the government, just for the record. It's a terrible idea, and this was a perfect example of it. So Germany ended up sort of stumbling into war in 1914. Now, let it be said, I recommend Christopher Clark's The Sleepwalkers to you all. As the history of the outbreak of World War I, because the Germans were, it takes a lot of people to make something like that happen. The French were up to their ears in bad things. The British, too, were not being very helpful. So it's not all the Germans' fault. But it strikes me that it'd be rather less likely with Bismarck, because Bismarck was such a careful operator. I mean, he had such a careful, that line about politics is the art of the possible, that's Bismarck. Which is funny, because he sort of tried to make himself like he was a really ideologically driven guy, but he was a very canny politician in a way that the people following after him, I mean, once he was gone, then the German civil service had nobody there who really knew, was really very good at operating. Caprivi, who was his successor, was a naval officer and really took the job out of obligation. The king asked him to, and he said, you know, he felt like he had to, but he wasn't very good at it and didn't want to do it. In Germany in the 19th century, there was a lot of anti-Semitism. Let's just say it. But there were in lots of places in Germany. Now, one of the reasons why the eliminationist anti-Semitism thing doesn't hold very much water is that in the 1880s and 90s, there were actually anti-Semitic political parties in Germany. They were very regional. They never really got much traction electorally. And eventually, they just sort of petered out. But there was a sort of subtext, so to speak, or a sort of appreciation for racialist thinking in Germany. Most of it didn't originate there. So one of the main figures was this fellow, Arthur de Gobineau, who's a French count, French aristocrat and politician. He was the one who originally developed the idea of the Aryan master race. And I've mentioned this before for people who've seen it, put Aryan in quotes. It's pseudoscience. There is no Aryan race. It was this crackpot idea that Gobineau came up with, because he was fascinated with the sort of Aryan people, and Aryan here in sort of scientific sense means a group of people who, an ethnic group in northern India centuries ago. But he thought that they were the sort of progenitors of the aristocrats in Europe who were better than other people sort of by blood. In 1855, he published his essay on the inequality of human races, which is 1,400 pages long. These people, like, the books they write are sort of inverse in length to the amount that they have to say. Mein Kampf, if anybody's ever seen it, you can, you know, use it as a doorstop, and probably would be better advised to do so. And Hitler wrote a second volume of it, which is seldom read, probably for the best, since it's I suppose the best thing you can say about Mein Kampf is that it's worse than the original German. But anyway, he wrote this 1,400-page book in which he sort of put out this sort of theory of scientific racism. He was a sort of anthropologist and a sort of early-style sociologist. Aristocratic people are sort of superior by blood to commoners. Some races are better than others. He thought Northern Europeans were better than others. Among whom he counted French people. Aryan traits decline due to miscegenation with inferior races. And this, it's interesting too, because this term was then borrowed by pro-slavery people in the American South. Interestingly, his book was translated in published in the United States, I believe in 1857, although I'm not exactly sure. But they shortened it by about 1,000 pages. Yeah. And who can blame them? But they also cut out the part about Americans are inferior. Let me just, like, he thought that Americans were sort of already too mixed. And he didn't think it was like white-black mixing, which is why the sort of Southerners were fascinated with him. He thought it was like, you know, Southern Europeans and Northern Europeans. He thought that already, you know, America was compromised. He ended up being the ambassador of Brazil for a while, and he, on the one hand, sort of really promoted people move, like Northern Europeans moving to Brazil to create a sort of new white homeland. He ended up having to be sort of like spirited out of the country because he got in a beef with the son of a senator, which ended up in a fist fight in the street, like a real brawl, and he had to be sort of the president of Brazil went to the German or the French ambassador and said, or went to the French government and said, I'm going to declare him a persona non grata if you don't get him out of here right now. But he thought that Persia was the sort of spiritual home of the highest, the best racial sort of people. His book was much read among German aristocrats. Interestingly enough, at the Hohenzollern court, the Hohenzollern were the family that were the kings of Prussia in the way that the Tudors were the kings of England for a while. The language that everyone spoke was French. And the reason was French was seen as being like, you know, the language of educated, serious people. So Gobineau was very well thought of, and he was the inspiration for this drawing. It was originally a drawing that was done by the Kaiser, by the German Emperor, that was sort of then translated into a painting under the auspices of, although not actually by, Philipp zu Eulenburg, who was one of his advisors and who was a major figure in German conservatism. And it says, people of Europe, defend your most valuable goods, basically. And what you see is all of the sort of peoples of Europe. Here's Great Britain with her sort of throne, and Germany with kind of Valkyrie wings, and then sort of angel with a flaming sword. And the real enemy, he thought, was the Chinese. As a matter of fact, another term that he created was the yellow peril. But what you notice here, by the way, is what? These are all women. Right, so what's the theory here? The yellow people are coming for your white women. And this is a very powerful, you know, this is something that's it's worth sort of watching out for in regular political discourse. Whenever you experience this trope where, like, the non-white people are coming for the white women, you should always be a little suspicious when you hear that, because it's one of these sort of things that gets sort of repurposed every time, like, people want to get down on whites. Another major figure, and perhaps even more important, was Houston Stuart Chamberlain. He was born in England, grew up in France. He ended up being Richard Wagner's son-in-law, although long after Wagner died. He married his daughter Cosima, or he had an affair with Cosima while she was married to someone else, and then I think married her later. He was a real Francophile growing up, and then at the age of 23, heard Wagner's music, was just captivated by it, became convinced that German civilization was the greatest civilization. Eventually joined the Bayreuth circle, the circle around Wagner and Bayreuth. Promoted this concept of redemptive anti-Semitism, which was Jews are responsible for all the problems. And among these are capitalism, industrialization, materialism, and urbanization. Now, okay, you're going to look at this and say, capitalism and industrialization, what's so wrong with those? Well, he's not some raving communist, quite the contrary. He's a very old-style conservative, and for old-style conservatives, and I mean like 19th, conservatism only becomes a thing at the beginning of the 19th century, in the sort of wake of the French Revolution. The term doesn't even exist until the first or second decade of the 19th century. But the idea that the unrestrained free market destroyed traditional values was something that conservatives were very committed to. Likewise, industrialization. I mean, conservatives were into doing things the way things had always been done, and you know, the sort of creation of these dark satanic mills, to take a term from a different area, was clearly something different, right? I mean, it was a sort of blot on the landscape, and urbanization too. You know, people should live in small towns where you know everybody, and you know, you do your craft, and you do your craft, and we deal with each other face to face, and honestly, and materialism, like giving up on the sort of like spiritual values that have always kept Europe together. So this is old style conservatism, and it really found a resonance in Germany, where industrialization after 1871 particularly was proceeding very quickly, and where there was a lot of dislocation as this happened, a lot of very fast growth of the cities, the expansion of new industrial technologies. This was very a source of real dislocation, discomfort for people. And so Chamberlain's writings, which he published in Germany in 1899, he published Die Grundlagen des 19. Jahrhunderts, or the foundations of the 19th century, these really found resonance with people who felt like the modern world was a world that they didn't like, that they didn't understand. And anti-Semitism is central to this. Because anti-Semitism, you know, you've got all these problems, and who better to sort of focus them on than the person of the Jew? The Jew is the embodiment of all these problems. He's the industrialist. Worse, he's the finance capitalist who makes money by not doing anything, who makes money just out of money, by not producing anything. I mean, good, honest people make things, but what does the Jew make? Now, this is, of course, a gross distortion of the situation of Jews in European society, but it was one that had resonance with people, as we'll see going forward. And the third thing is the Protocols of the Elders of Zion. It's sometimes described as a forgery. That's not really the right term, because a forgery indicates there's some real thing that this is a fake copy of. What it was a fabricated document, and if you've ever read it, I really recommend finding a copy of this and reading it, because it's absolutely bizarre. It's sort of like the minutes from the secret meeting about how we're going to take over the world. I mean, the only thing that's missing is like someone going like this and saying, "Whoa!" I mean, it's really like you know, we the Jews are responsible for all these things that are going to destroy European culture. And it's like, yeah, we are. This is, you know, it's just bizarre. It was sort of concocted by Tsarist secret agents sometime around 1902 or 1903, and they plagiarized a lot of the text from a sort of mid-century anti-Semitic philosophical tract by a guy named Maurice Joly. It was disseminated worldwide. As a matter of fact, Henry Ford was a great lover of this book. And if you bought a Model T, you got a free copy of the Protocols, which is, you know, and let's face it, there was a lot of anti-Semitism in the United States too. I mean, so, you know, we should not, one of the things people want to do about anti-Semitism, about fascism or whatever, is sort of say, well, it's a German problem. And there's a certain amount of truth to that, because they were the ones really driving the process in this period, in the period, you know, after about 1933. But as it turns out, they were just the sort of leading edge of something that was going on in a lot of places. And we want to be careful if we kind of engage in a kind of intellectual prophylaxis in which we just sort of say, well, it's the Germans, we don't have to worry about it. Germany went into the First World War and felt like they were doing pretty good, although they did get stopped on the Marne in 1914. Two things during the war that went on. One was the war was financed on a series of loans and gross inflation. As a matter of fact, we'll talk later about the hyperinflation in 1923. But if you look at it, serious inflation was already happening in Germany starting in 1916 because of the way they were financing the war. I mean, war is obscene, but it's obscenely expensive. In order to make it happen year after year, you had to come up with large amounts. You had to be basically writing IOUs for stuff that you didn't have. But also there was very heavy press censorship. And so it was that the German population came around to 1918 and were very surprised to learn in the late autumn that they were about to lose. The German high command, Erich Ludendorff and Paul von Hindenburg, had known since late summer that there was no way they were winning. They had sort of made their last throw and it wasn't happening. So they began a process of switching responsibility for the whole thing off onto the civilian authorities. I mean, Ludendorff and Hindenburg had been running Germany roughly dictatorially since about 1916. But all of a sudden, they started kind of putting off authority onto the civilians. And why did they do this? Because they knew that some bad things were going to go down, and they didn't want to be on the hook for them. So that when they finally, when the armistice was finally declared in November 1918, they had handed over power to a civilian government under Prince Max von Baden. And when the negotiations for the Versailles Treaty were going on, the people there were mostly members of the largest party in the Reichstag, in the parliament, who were the Social Democrats. And so the Treaty of Versailles, which I believe is the next slide here, had some very ugly things in it from a German perspective. Germany lost 25,000 square miles of territory, including, I mean, Alsace-Lorraine, well, they'd only taken that in 1871, and it's about 50% German anyway. But this area here they lost to Poland, and this is West Prussia, which is the real heartland of Prussia, including a large part of Pomerania. And Poland was going to be landlocked, right? So the people doing the Treaty of Versailles said, well, we want to make sure that they have access to the sea. So they made Danzig, which the Poles called Gdansk, a free city. And they created this corridor, the Danzig Corridor, which cut off East Prussia, which is sort of like the real heartland of the oldest, most conservative Prussian nobility. And this was a real shock to people. I mean, in addition, they lost all of their very considerable colonial possessions in the Cameroons, in Southwest Africa, in what's now Namibia. The German army was limited to 100,000 men of all ranks, no heavy equipment, only three military colleges. Germany was forced to sign an article that said they were solely responsible for the war. And that really left a bad taste in people's mouth. And they were also forced to pay 20 billion gold marks in reparations, which is 5 billion US dollars in the time, and that's a lot of money. At a certain point in the early 20s, they tried not to pay, and the French just occupied the Ruhr, like the heaviest industrial part of Germany, or one of the heaviest. But so this was an incredible shock to people, because they had gone along thinking, we're going to win this thing. And all of a sudden, in the space of months, leading up to a very cold winter during which there were intense shortages of food and every other material that you might want, all of a sudden, we're on the losing end, and not only are we on the losing end, but we're bad people. And this goes a long way when you're wondering why Germans believed a lot of things that Hitler said to them. Nobody likes being told that they're a bad person. If somebody comes up to you, and even with very good reason says Americans are bad people, you're not going to want to hear that, right? I mean, nobody wants to hear that. And the Germans, no worse than anyone else, and it was a very big shock to them that that was the way that, you know, they were being described. So they came up with ways to explain it, and one of them was what's called the Dolchstoßlegende, or the legend of the stab in the back. And the theory was this, that Germany would have won if it hadn't been for Jews and war profiteers, who were mostly Jews, and socialists who had stabbed the German army in the back. And here we see the German soldier in his Stahlhelm in the trench, and this figure, he's with a knife about to stab him in the back. He's got the Star of David, that's a real tip-off, but he's got the big hooked nose and big ears. He's got the very sensual lips. And they drew him with breasts to make him more effeminate, because the premise being that Jews can't be properly masculine. Here are a couple of others. Here are, once again, German soldiers in the trenches. It says, Germans, think about it. And what we have is these, like, war profiteers. These ones look really Jewish. These ones only look sort of Jewish, but anybody who looked at it would get the point. Once again, we have the German soldier getting stabbed in the back by someone in red, red being the color of the communists. The Social Democrats. The Communist Party didn't come around until a little bit later, but the Social Democrats. You can see from this, which hopefully you can read, that starting in the pre-war period, a mark was about, it was about 20 marks to the pound, about 4 marks to the dollar. This is, for a long time, the sort of standard rate was $4.70 to the pound, so that's... But you can kind of see by, you know, it's going up slowly here. By February 1920, it's at $100 to the mark. Or 100 marks to the dollar, excuse me. January 1921, it's gone back a little. They've gotten a little better sort of control of their financial house. January 1922, it's at 200 to 227, and then 1923, things start to get really crazy. In December of 1922, it's 6,750 marks to the dollar. In June 1923, it's 900,000 and then goes up to 11.4 million marks to the dollar. Inflation was rising so fast that if you went to dinner in a restaurant, you were obliged to pay when you ordered, because there was a very good chance that the price was going to go up by the time you finished, and that's not a joke. Here you can see German children playing with gigantic stacks of bills. Now, what effect did the hyperinflation have? Well, a moderate amount of inflation is good for debtors, because it makes the money in which your debt is denominated cheaper, right? So, if I engage a debt at a point where the mark is, it's 4 marks to the dollar, and I pay it back owing the same amount of money in marks, right, but the mark is 6,750 marks to the dollar, you know, I can pay it back and still have, you know, say I take out a loan for 1,000 marks, the mark is like 1,500 times less valuable overall. I can just pay it off. And so people who were holding debts really got burned. But also small savers got burned. lower middle class people who had spent their entire lives saving up their money, you know, to buy a little house in the country or something like that. And then all of a sudden, all this money that you've been socking away is just worthless. Now, the reason this happened, people talk about like, oh, you know, debasement of the currency. This is one of these things I feel the need to, as a sort of person who's read the literature on it, debt, a lot, the key with debt is what currency it's denominated in. People talk about, oh, the United States has all these debts, but they're all denominated in our own currency. And unless the people in the Treasury Department forget how to use a printing press, we can't become insolvent. We can have some other problems, but hyperinflation just doesn't result from more money, printing more money. Hyperinflation results from having a foreign exchange problem. So the Germans had to come up with gold to pay the French, mostly. The British too, but the French. And so it wasn't until we stepped in, with a series of plans, the Dawes Plan and the Young Plan, to restructure that debt. We basically loaned the Germans the money to pay the French. And then the French paid us the money that they owed us with the money that the Germans were paying them. Which sounds like a screwed up system, except that it's better than the alternative. I mean, I think that's what it had going for it. But the hyperinflation was very jarring to people. Because, you know, what's more a sign of stability to you than the money you have in your pocket? And if all of a sudden, like, you know, I pull out a 20 now, you know, I can get a meal or I can get a couple of six packs, whatever, and all of a sudden that money's not worth anything. That's just, you know, it made people really question what society was about, and it made them really question what capitalism was about. It made them really think, like, you know, there are these people, I mean, German banks did very well, by the way, for reasons that I think are probably fairly obvious. But the key here is because they could get assets denominated in other currencies and also move their assets to other countries. People thought, well, you know, these big capitalists and the bankers, they did great and we all got jammed. And this was a thing that is part of the German mindset now. Not as much as the Bundesbank would have you believe. But it's still there. The Weimar Republic, which was put together in the course of 1919, Weimar is a city in sort of central eastern Germany. It's the kind of cultural capital of Germany. It's where Goethe lived. The Republic was rocked in its early years by a series of armed uprisings. First, the Spartacist uprising. The Spartacists were a sort of splinter group, like far left splinter group. They were, whoops, well done, boyo. I did that wrong. There we go. They staged an uprising in January 1919. It was not very well organized. It was put down quite savagely by members of what were called the Freikorps. The Freikorps were groups of demobilized soldiers, of whom there were an awful lot in Germany at that point, who formed themselves into paramilitary organizations. And the Freikorps, who were sort of, at this point, the government was being run by the Social Democratic Party. And now you may think, oh, the Social Democratic Party, they're like a bunch of leftists. Not really so much. Friedrich Ebert, the head of the Social Democratic Party, said that he hated revolution like sin. And so when this broke out, Gustav Noske, who's another major Social Democrat, who was a defense minister, basically let the Freikorps loose. And they ended up executing, I mean, summary execution was pretty much the coin of the realm in cleaning that up. In April and May 1919, there was what was called the Bavarian Soviet Republic. We'll talk about that a little more in a second here. In March 1920, there was the Kapp-Lüttwitz Putsch. Wolfgang Kapp was a conservative attempt to take over the state. And basically, they tried to seize the government. The Social Democrats called a general strike. The army said that they wouldn't fire on the Freikorps members who were running it. The Social Democratic government went to the army and said, we want you to put this down. The General von Seeckt, the head of the German army, said, no, we won't shoot at fellow soldiers. So the Social Democrats called a general strike, and it absolutely shut the entire country down. And after about a week, the people running the uprising had to surrender. In August 1921, Matthias Erzberger, who had been the finance minister, although he was out of office at that point, was assassinated in Berlin the next year by a group called the Organization Consul, who were a sort of far-right terrorist organization. In June of 1922, Walter Rathenau, who was the foreign minister at the time, was also assassinated by the same group. Rathenau was a major industrialist and a Jew, but he had done a lot of, I think, fairly valuable work in getting Germany sort of back toward even keel. And you notice that sort of it's after this that the really bad economic things start to happen. So there's a kind of period where it's sort of starting to get better inflation-wise, and then after the middle of 1922, it starts to get very bad very fast. There were a lot of sort of organizations of people in Germany at this time who were kind of secret organizations of the far right, and the most important one probably is what's called the Thule Gesellschaft, the Thule Society. It was founded in 1918 as the study group for German antiquity. They were fascinated with the history of the Aryan race, going back to Gabino. Members had to swear that they had no Jewish or colored blood. Their symbol was the swastika. They were instrumental in founding a party. They were centered in Munich. Here's a funny thing about Germany. So Germany is heavily Protestant in the northern part. Bavaria is like the Catholicest place you've ever been. But the Nazis were sort of funny about religion. They went to great lengths once they got into power to sort of show that Christ was not actually a Semite of any kind, was not a Jew. They tried to create their own German Christianity. And they created these research institutes. There's a great book by a woman named Susanna Heschel called The Aryan Jesus, which I really recommend if you want to see just how loopy they're sort of. You really have to do some pretty serious gymnastics to try and prove that Jesus of Nazareth was not Jewish, whatever else you might want to say about him. There were a lot of people in the Thule Society who were pretty well off, actually, pretty sort of in the sort of higher reaches of Munich society. But there were also a lot of down and dirty guys willing to assassinate people in the street, like this fellow Anton, the Count of Arco of Valley, my picture of him disappeared, unfortunately. But he's important because in 1918, right before the end of the war, so this is 7 November 1918, the Social Democrats, led by Kurt Eisner in Munich, not Munch, in Munich, stage a kind of bloodless coup. By that time, so once again, the sort of army had stepped back because they wanted the civilian authorities to step forward to be on the hook for the bad things that they knew were going to happen. Eisner and his followers, who were members of the sort of radical, so the Social Democratic Party was in the process of splitting into the mainline Social Democratic Party and the Independent Social Democratic Party, or USPD. The USPD eventually merged with what was left of the Spartacists, the ones who hadn't gotten killed, to become the Communist Party of Germany. So they set up a sort of social democratic government. They stage elections in January 1919, which they lose catastrophically. Eisner is walking down the street in Munich, and Count Arco comes up and shoots him, kills him. It turned out, when they examined his body, that his resignation was in his, he was going to the parliament building to resign. But Arco, shooting Kurt Eisner was sort of Arco's attempt to get into the Thule Society. But the Thule Society are also important because they form this party, this political party, called the German Workers' Party, the Deutsche Arbeiterpartei, or DAP. While this is happening, in April, even more radical leftists take over and form a what's called a council republic, or a Soviet republic. Soviet is the Russian word for council. And in the wake of the Russian Revolution, ideally what was supposed to happen is there would be these councils of workers and soldiers who would run the country. Under Lenin, it didn't quite turn out that way. But that's what they wanted to do here. And essentially they tried to sort of they nationalized all the industry. They took over the University of Munich. Gustav Landauer, the anarchist poet, was running the University of Munich, said it was going to be free to everybody, except nobody could study history. History, that enemy of the people, will no longer be taught, which I really take personally. The central government of Germany started to crack down. The communists ended up executing a series of hostages. One was Countess Hella von Westarp, who was the secretary of the Thule Society, and about six other Thule Society members, and also some Freikorps members who had been captured. The Freikorps, who were much better armed, then moved into Munich and really cracked down very hard. This is Ernst Toller. Toller was out of power by the time this all happened. This is Eugen Levine. He was captured and executed in the central prison. Gustav Landauer was captured, taken to the central prison. His face was smashed in with rifle butts. He was shot twice. Then he was kicked to death, and his body was left in the central prison yard for 2 days to make the point that you shouldn't do things like this. Adolf Hitler. It's taken kind of a long time to get to Adolf Hitler, but here we are. Hitler was born in Austria. His father was a sort of minor official. I'll talk more about him. He's one of the figures we're doing I'm doing in major leaders of the Second World War. He had a very bad relationship with his father. He apparently caught a daily thrashing, although his mother said that he kind of deserved it. He wanted to be an artist. He was never very good at sort of sticking with things. He moved to Vienna. He wanted to become an artist. He lived kind of rough. He applied to the Academy of Fine Arts in 1907. He was rejected. He applied in 1908. He was rejected again. The head of the Academy didn't even look at his application the second time. Said, really, you don't, this isn't your thing, trust me. Maybe you want to be an architect. And so for a long time, Hitler went around saying that he was going to be an architect. Those of you who've like watched Seinfeld, there's a whole season where George Costanza is sort of fantasizing about being an architect. And I sort of think that there must be some that this is a kind of nasty joke that the Seinfeld people are telling about Hitler, because Hitler was a sort of, he failed at pretty much everything until he moved to Munich. He got an inheritance when his father died, and it allowed him to do nothing for about a year. He moved to Munich because there was universal military service in Austria-Hungary at that time, and he didn't want to do it. Partly because he didn't like the Austro-Hungarian Empire, because he was very convinced German nationalist, and he thought that Austria-Hungary is one of these old-style European monarchies that's made up of different ethnic groups, Germans and Czechs and Poles and Ruthenians and Romanians and Hungarians and what have you. So he moves to Munich and does a lot of nothing while he's he goes to see a lot of operas. He had this friend, he and his friend used to go see operas constantly. They were just fascinated with Wagner. So every time Wagner was playing, they would go see it like three or four times. When the war breaks out, he enlists in the Bavarian army. Each German state had its own army in those days. They figured out that he was Austrian, and really he was only allowed to be in the, they sort of did an investigation about it later. And it was really only through a sort of clerical blunder that he was allowed to stay in the Bavarian army, that he should have been sent back to serve in the Austrian army. He would have been serving on the same side, roughly. By the way, speaking of German anti-Semitism, I forgot this earlier, but it's worth mentioning. 1916, the German army decided to do a study because they were worried about how many people were being killed and who was going to run the army. And they wanted to sort of show that Jews were... They did a study, the premise of which was, we want to see what the proportion of Jews in frontline units are. And the theory was, they'll be underrepresented. and overrepresented in administrative units. And in fact, what it turned out was that Jews were overrepresented in frontline, statistically overrepresented in frontline combat units. And so the study was suppressed. Anyway, Hitler participates in the First World War. He spends most of his time as a runner, as a dispatch runner, which is very dangerous. In every, you know, the frontline guys, when they go over the lip of the trench, that's the most dangerous part. But he had to run back and forth between the trenches and the sort of command posts behind, and the enemy is constantly doing sort of harassment and interdiction type fire. So it's a very dangerous thing. He eventually won the Iron Cross for doing it, which is very rare for someone at his level in the army. Eventually he gets caught in a gas attack in 1918, and he's in hospital when, to his utter shock, the armistice is announced and Germany loses. And he just, you know, if you read what he says about it, he was absolutely gutted by the whole thing. So he didn't really know what to do. You know, he didn't really have a job. He'd been sort of futzing around on his father's inheritance before the war, and then he was worried. So he stayed in the army, which was hard to do, but he managed to do it. And he was in Munich, and the army started organizing these anti-socialist training courses where soldiers would go for a weekend or whatever and get harangued about how bad socialism was. And he really took to it, and it turned out that he not only quite enjoyed it, but that he was good at it. He already hated socialism, and he wasn't real thrilled about the Jews either. And he really he impressed the people doing the courses with his, not only his fervor, but that he was actually a pretty good orator. Some of you have heard me tell this story before, but I at one point was teaching the history of the Holocaust, and I was showing Leni Riefenstahl's The Triumph of the Will, and I had to bring my own DVD player because the one in the room was broken, and I forgot to bring the remote, so I couldn't turn the subtitles on. So I had to translate on the fly, and it was like sing along with Hitler. And and I had never really paid attention. Hitler comes off to us as this weird sort of screechy guy with a bad mustache, and he's, you know, he's a very strange looking man, and his mode of talking is very strange. And he seemed that way in a way to Germans at the time. He's from Austria. He has this bizarre, like those of you, I don't know if there's anyone who speaks German here, but the Austrian accent is just bizarre. I mean, the Bavarian accent is weird, but the Austrian accent is very odd. Also, just for the record, we'll get into this more in the Hitler talk. His father did him a really great favor about 13 years before he was born, because his father's original name was Schickelgruber. And it takes a real effort of imagination to imagine 10,000 people standing around going, "Hail Schickelgruber." So anyway, he becomes part of this group, the training group, and then they start sending him off to infiltrate sort of right-wing groups around Munich. And he ends up getting sent to a Deutsche Arbeiterpartei meeting, and he finds that he really likes what's going on there. Their views are very much commensurate with his. He hates Jews, so do they. He hates socialism, so do they. He's iffy about capitalism, but only because he thinks that, you know, not because he has a problem with private property by any stretch, but because he thinks that it should be sort of small producers, you know, working face to face. And he eventually gets very hooked into this movement. They changed the name to the National Socialistische Deutsche Arbeiterpartei. And the reason why they enter socialism into the name is not because they're really all about socialism, but because they feel like they're competing for members with the Social Democrats. And they thought that putting socialism in the name would make them more attractive to the urban workers, who they thought were the sort of like people who would drive this thing. The NSDAP ends up getting in a sort of running conflict with the Bavarian government, the government of Munich particularly, which is being run by Gustav von Kahr, Hans von Zeisser, and Otto von Lassow, who's the Reichswehr military officer running things. It's worth noting that they all have the von particle in their name, which means that they're all aristocrats. They were sort of running Munich with dictatorial powers. Hitler became convinced, as he sort of had worked his way up in the NSDAP, he eventually sort of took it over, that they were going to abrogate the Constitution and declare sort of, you know, go back to the sort of, you know, bring back the Wittelsbach family or whatever. And so on the 8th of November, Carr is addressing 3,000 people in this beer hall. Hitler shows up with 600 SA men and a machine gun, walks into the room, one of his associates fires a couple of rounds into the ceiling, and he says, the National Revolution is starting now. And he drags von Kahr and von Lossow, I don't think von Zeisser was there at the moment, into a back room and starts saying, okay, we're going to have the German Revolution right now. You're on board, right? In a way such that the possible consequences of not being on board with this program were not too hard to gather. So they say, sure, yeah, we're on board, let's go. So the problem was that it was a total botch job. They didn't take over any of the government buildings that they were meant to. As soon as von Kahr and von Lossow got away from them, they immediately started calling up the police and saying, you know, we've got to get a handle on these people. By the next day, Hitler decides they're going to march to the center government. So they march to the Odeonplatz here. This is what's called the Feldherrenhalle, where they're stopped by a whole host of Bavarian state police who read them the riot act and tell them to go home. You can kind of see, here's the sort of beginning of it. Here's a bunch of stormtroopers. Here's some more. Somebody opens fire. It's not clear who. But there's a pretty serious exchange of fire. The guy next to Hitler is blown away. As a matter of fact, if the bullet had been like 11 inches to the other side, history might have turned out very differently. Although, I'm not one of these people who thinks that, I mean, individuals can have power in history, I know, but I don't necessarily know that getting rid of Hitler would have fixed the problem. I mean, it would have been a better idea to go back and convince his father not to change his name from Schickelgruber, probably. Four policemen are killed and about 14 Nazis. The only person who doesn't go down, by the way, is Ludendorff, who as a sort of German military officer just stands there while the shooting is going on. Hitler ends up getting arrested, and he and his sort of main associates are put on trial. And the trial turns into a total farce. The judge just basically allows Hitler to make speeches from the witness box about, you know, what he thinks needs to happen to Germany. And it goes on for several months of this just, you know, circus basically being run by Hitler. And this is a sort of defining feature of the Weimar Republic. It was very politically slanted to the right, so that people who committed crimes who were leftists got very severe sentences. Hitler, for staging a putsch that nearly toppled the Bavarian government and got almost 20 people killed, got 5 years of protective detention. It's Festhaftung, not like jail. And he only serves 8 months. And he serves it in this room, surrounded by friends and well-wishers. As a matter of fact, this was the cell that Count Arco, who had shot Kurt Eisner, was in. They kicked him out and put Hitler in it. But you can see there's Hess with this sort of sloping brow type thing going on. He was getting so many visitors that he had to stop taking them. He was working on his book. He's working on Mein Kampf. And he had to like cut off the flow of visitors because it was just getting to be too much. Don't bother reading Mein Kampf. Oh God, it's a terrible book. But one of the things that he did say, and this is really true, and you can sort of apply this to modern mass culture however you want to, the big lie, there's always a force of credibility because the broad masses of a nation are always more easily corrupted in the deeper strata of their emotional nature than consciously or voluntarily, and thus in the primitive simplicity of their minds, they more readily fall victim to the big lie than the small lie, since they themselves often tell small lies in some little matters, but would be ashamed to resort to large-scale falsehoods. It would never come into their heads to fabricate colossal untruths, and they would not believe that others could have the impudence to distort the truth so infamously. So if you're going to lie, tell a big lie, because people will assume you wouldn't lie about that. You know, I had people say this to me, you know, after, okay, so I had a roommate in high school. We were in library school. We were in library school during 9/11. I'm not a 9/11 conspiracy person. Neither was he. But we were talking about it with somebody, and somebody was saying some conspiratorial thing. And Corey was like, well, no, they wouldn't lie about that. I was like, well, OK, I don't think this is a conspiracy, but let's just get off the idea that people won't tell lies about serious things, because they do it all the time. Nobody read Mein Kampf. People bought lots of copies of it because it was a good thing to have on the coffee table to show that you were down with the program. But Mein Kampf is just, it's God, it's turgid. It's really bad. It's just a horrific, horrific book. What ended up happening in Germany was that the major, as the sort of republic got more and more unstable, there was a kind of a sort of Indian summer, if you will, to use a somewhat inappropriate term, between the sort of currency stabilization in 1924 and the beginning of the Depression, 1929. But through this period, the major parties all started their own fighting, street fighting groups. This is the this is a unit of Sturmabteilung in Essen. Sturmabteilung just means like the storm group, stormtroopers. But the Social Democrats and the other sort of central parties in the Republic also had their own group. This is the Reichsbanner, Schwarz-Rot-Gold, the Reichsbanner, black, red, gold. The flag of the Republic was black, red, and gold. The flag of the German Empire had been black, red, and white. And the far right people didn't like the gold color. They used to sort of compare it to the color of urine. But this, once again, the uniform fighting guys. And a lot of them from the Social Democratic Party, but also from the center party, the main party of German Catholicism. And the German Democratic Party, who are the sort of central liberal party. Boy, all right, there we go. This is the Rote Front Kampfverbund, the Red Front Fighters. That's Willy Leov, and that's Ernst Thälmann. And you can kind of tell what he's down for. It's not too hard to figure out, because he's walking around with his fist up. And once again, this was the communist fighting group. And these people would duke it out in the streets constantly. As a matter of fact, the German government passed a firearms law in 1928. And the reason was because the private armies were shooting each other in the streets, and they wanted to try and get a lid on who had weapons. By the way, people will tell you, like, oh, the Nazis took our guns, which is really not true. The Nazis didn't pass a firearms law until 1938. It actually made guns easier to come by for most people, people who weren't Jews. And in fact, the idea that, it's this idea that people are like, oh, you know, if we'd only had guns, we could oppose Hitler, which Hitler was fabulously popular until about the end of 1943. It wasn't like, oh, you know, if we just had some guns, we'd get rid of Hitler. Like, people loved him. Until the shortages start to bite after the loss at Stalingrad and after, you know, things got worse and worse. And if you're wondering how many people this involved, this is a Red Front Fighters march. This is the Berliner Dom, middle of central Berlin. This is an area called the Lustgarten. And there's a lot of people there. This is a, that's a Reichsbanner march. And you can see the lines goes back all the way. This is in Berlin too. There's a SA, Sturmabteilung in march. So basically, I mean, there's one place, I think it was in Prenzlauer Berg in Berlin, where there was like a Nazi bar on one side of the street and a communist bar on the other side. And about 3:30 every day, they'd all pour out, have a good old brawl, and then go back for some more steins. After Hitler gets out of prison, they mostly engage in a kind of electoral strategy. And what they find is they're not really very popular in the cities, but they're very popular in the country, where people really got jammed by the inflation. And they pursue this electoral strategy. This is in those days you could really campaign outside of polling centers. So this is the these three downward pointing arrows is the symbol for the Iron Front, the Eisner Front, which was the sort of like social democratic attempt to kind of respond to Nazi whatever. Let's see, here's the National Socialist. This I believe is I could read it before. I think it's the German Democratic Party, but I'm not sure. This is a German Democratic Party electoral placard. German women and mothers, think of the future of your children. Now, what you can see here is, so these are the parties that are supporting the Republic in the 505-seat German parliament. The Social Democratic Party, the Center Party, which was the Catholic Party, the Deutsche Demokratische Partei, the German Democratic Party, who were basically progressive liberals. The Bavarian Volkspartei, they were the sort of Bavarian version of the Center Party, Catholic Party. And the DVP, who were very conservative but still thought the Republic was okay. And then you have at the edges the Communist Party and the Independent Social Democratic Party, who merge after 1920. And then on this end, the Deutsche Nationale Volkspartei, the German National People's Party, and the Nazis. These ones, the darker ones, are against, think the Republic is a bad idea and want to get rid of it. They want to do it electorally. Hitler basically agrees, like, you know, I'm going to confine myself to electoral strategies. And you can kind of see, so the Social Democrats are a very large party in here. They, for a lot of the time, they're the majority. But what happens is that after 1928, it gets a lot closer in the Reichstag. And the Reichstag basically, you know, I'm sure most of you know how a parliamentary system works. That is to say, you get a majority, some coalition of parties, such that you have a majority of the votes, and you form a government. Well, after a certain point in Germany, you couldn't get enough people together to form a government. But you could always get enough people together to have a vote of no confidence, which would require another election. As a matter of fact, the German Constitution, when they rewrote the German Constitution in 1948, they specifically inserted a clause in it that says you can't have a negative majority. So you can't have a vote of no confidence in Germany unless you already have enough votes to form another government. And it's to keep this from happening. Because what you see here is that, so the up until this point, the central parties, the Republic-favoring parties, have enough votes to form a government. They have about 270 votes. Once we get to here, they only have 248. They need 250-some. So they can't form a government. And this happens around the time that the Great Depression kicks in, when unemployment after 1929, the GDP falls by 15%. By comparison, the Great Recession that we had caused worldwide GDP to decline by about 1%. By 1932, 30% of the working population are unemployed. And that's grim. And what do you do if you're unemployed? Well, you'd be not unwilling to perhaps join a group to fix things, or maybe beat up people you disagree with. Hitler eventually got out of, the way everybody got out of the Depression was expansionary spending. We did it with the New Deal after some fits and starts. Hitler did it by building the Autobahn system and by spending fantastic sums of money on military equipment. These are just some National Socialist posters. I think this is the interesting one because here we have Hitler and Paul von Hindenburg. Paul von Hindenburg was the president of Germany. The president was a sort of figurehead position who was meant to kind of give moral leadership to the country. It's a funny picture because Hindenburg really hated Hitler. He used to refer to him as that Bavarian corporal, or the Austrian corporal. Hindenburg was sort of aristocratic, old school Prussian. So the idea that they had a cordial handshake like this at any point is tough to swallow. The Nazis really like to appeal to women. They really work the women vote pretty heavily, which is funny because in the wake of the war, women really, in the wake of the First World War, women took on a role in German society that they had never really had before because so many more of them were working. So many more of them had actual income to spend. I mean, German soldiers, one of the really jarring things for the German soldiers was they got back and they saw these women with bob haircuts running around central Berlin spending money, buying cosmetics, smoking cigarettes. And that was a jarring thing for them. Because they had really, you know, they had this image in their mind of what the society was going to be like when they got back. And it wasn't like that. But the German, the Nazis, you know, you look, what is this woman's sort of central thing? Like, her husband is kind of bummed out. She's like taking care of her kids, and what she really needs is some people like the Nazis to come along to rebuild the structure of German society. Well, as you got this gridlock where nobody could form a government, one of the seriously unfortunate aspects of the German constitution, the Weimar Constitution, came into play. Article 48. Article 48 basically said that if you get an emergency situation and you can't, and the president needs to, the president can just rule by decree. And since no one could form a government, Hindenburg then ended up ruling by decree. And the guy he put in power was Heinrich Brüning, who was a Catholic Center Party politician. And Brüning was like, well, what we need to do is kick up interest rates and roll back wages and salaries. This made him extremely unpopular, not surprisingly. So unpopular that he had to sort of curtail the freedom of the press because he was just getting powdered. But the fact of the matter was, another thing he wanted to do was get rid of trade unions. And so what he does after about 1930 is start this deflationary spiral where wages go down, so people can't buy things, so you have to cut the price. But if you're cutting the price, then you can't pay out wages, and the process continues. A deflationary spiral, Pache, what you'll hear in some of the financial press, is far worse than inflation. And in fact, it's the deflationary spiral that eventually brings Hitler to power, because finally, now you can see, I'll just jump back if I don't completely destroy things. Okay, come on you. There we go. What you see is the Nazis getting an ever greater proportion. As a matter of fact, in the election of July 1932, they get 230 seats in a 500-member parliament, which means that they only need the DNVP to vote with them. Although, in fact, by this time, the Communist Party is voting with them. Because the Communist Party thinks that National Socialism is the last stage of capitalism. When capitalism, you know, democratic capitalism no longer works, and the capitalists have to resort to sort of naked physical force. But it's the last stage, and then at the end of the last stage, there'll be the proletarian revolution. This turned out to be a very stupid idea. Because nobody liked the communists less than the Nazis did. And thousands of, of communists paid with their lives for this piece of idiocy. I mean, it was just, you know, really, if you ever wonder about the possible consequences of a wrong theory, there they are, right, in black and white for you. But what you also see is a kind of flight away from the center. And finally, Hitler is so prominent. Now, the election of March 1933 doesn't count because by that point the Nazis were like beating up anybody who tried to vote for other parties. But Hindenburg was very reluctant to allow Hitler to be in power because he just thought of him as kind of low-class street scum, basically. But by the end of 1932, things had gotten to such a pass that Hitler was the only one there. And people thought, people among the conservatives thought, well, Hitler says a lot of crazy things, and he does have a lot of armed thugs around. But, you know, there's an old German proverb that goes something like, soup is cooked hotter than it's eaten, right? If you get him into power, being in government will sort of knock the rough edges off the guy, and he'll, like, figure out how to be a civilized person. Which turned out to be a gross miscalculation. So on the 30th of January, 1933, Hindenburg finally says, okay, Hitler, you can be chancellor. You see if you can work this out. On the 24th of March, in a session of the Reichstag, which was characterized by the communists' complete absence because they had already been made illegal, and by Nazi stormtroopers surrounding the members of the other delegations, a law called the Enabling Law was passed, which essentially allowed Hitler to govern, to make laws without running through the Reichstag. And that was the moment at which the Republic was finally dead. Yeah. So there's a lot more that could be said about this, and I know I've gone on for a really long time. I'm going to tell more of this story and hook it in when I end up doing the second lecture, and I'll let you all know when that is. I just have to schedule it. But so I've gone through a lot of things, and I'm sure people have questions. So that's what I'm going to say for now, and if people have questions, please feel free.